Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Basics of Resistance, The Practical Freedomista, Book 1, by Claire Wolfe and Kit Perez. Narrated by Francine Waverly. Introduction. Who is this book for? This book is for anyone who loves individual freedom enough to take individual action to save or restore it. We live in a day when free speech, gun rights, and other fundamentals of liberty are under attack. Government power grows no matter who's in charge. Diversity means we can all look different, but must think precisely alike, or else. The economy hangs by a thread. The principles that have maintained individual liberty are being forgotten or trampled. The time we live in is a time when freedom needs people who will defend it with their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honors. We call these people Freedomistas. A more traditional term might be freedom fighters, but that expression has been woefully misused, often by people who cry freedom as an excuse for imposing authority and terror. A Freedomista doesn't just want to impose some theoretical concept on others. He or she wants to live free and act for freedom, personally. Practical Freedomistas want to do it well, having thought out their plans and taken intelligent actions. Some actions might require the level of sacrifice from us implied by lives, fortunes, and sacred honors. There are other equally important actions with far less personal cost. Freedom needs fighters. But it also needs people who are able to perpetrate a damn good joke at a tyrant's expense, then slink away into the night. It needs tricksters who are willing to throw a monkey wrench into the system. It needs communicators who use unconventional techniques to change hearts and minds. It needs Robin Hoods who remind ordinary folks that someone clever and daring is on their side. Freedom needs dedicated people who can see past instant gratification or personal validation in favor of making a difference that could echo for generations. The activities those dedicated souls pursue are boundless and varied. All come under the heading of resistance. This book is for you if you've realized that polite political action is not enough. You want to do more. You want to be more than just somebody who grouses about the present and hopes for change. This book is for you if you want to learn to resist and strike back against authority, but to do so with cleverness, not aggressive violence. Basics of Resistance will give you ideas on how to resist. There are many ways. It will teach you to guard your own security as you confront tyrants, large and small. It will help you form a resistance group or conduct a one-person revolution. It will tell you about allies, associates, supporters, and core members, and the differences between them. It will give you a few ideas to try and a sample blueprint for carrying out a resistance action. It will regale you with stories about giants of resistance, past and present. It will help you learn from others' mistakes so you can avoid making your own. It will, we hope, inspire you to act, and act wisely. This book is not for you if you want to blow stuff up. It is not for you if you want to conduct paramilitary exercises with tactical apparators operating operationally, then crow about them on social media. It is not for you if you crave public attention as a commando or want to amass legions of fawning followers. It is not for you if you merely want to carry out a personal grudge against someone in officialdom who has done you wrong. It is not for you if you think a noisy street demonstration that gets a few minutes of media attention is the epitome of action. It is very much for you if you want to be a genuine Freedomista, and one who is effective, safe, and active long enough to get the real job of liberty done. Basics of Resistance is just that. Basic. It will not teach you everything you'll ever need. There are some advanced forms of freedom fighting that are, frankly, too dangerous to talk about, in a time when people are getting arrested for mere opinions. There are others that are simply beyond the scope of this book. But by the time you've reached the end, and perhaps delved into our extensive resource section, you'll know where you need to begin and how to get where you want to go. This book is for you if you're both a freedom fighter and a freedom thinker who can quietly lead the way or go your own way in the cause of individual liberty. Kit's Secret to Individual Freedom. Freedom seekers are always looking for the one big secret to being free. Often, though, freedom is in the small, everyday choices we make. It's certainly never in the big political decisions we demand some other person carry out for us. Kit says there is a secret, though, and only we as individuals can apply it. 1. Decide which tyrannical, soul-sucking, fake things you're willing to ignore, do without, or work around. 2. Understand potential consequences of said action. 3. Do it. There, do that and you'll be immediately more free and be contributing to a freer world, no matter what anybody else does or doesn't do. 1. What is resistance? It is easier to resist at the beginning than at the end. Leonardo da Vinci. Resistance is taking matters into your own hands. Resistance is what you do when an injustice has gone too far, or a system has become so corrupt that your morality compels you to say, "It stops with me." Resistance does not ask permission of those in authority. It does not plead, petition, compromise, or stage shows in front of the media in hopes of getting the attention of legislators. Such shows aren't necessarily wrong or futile. They just aren't usually resistance. Resistance asks nothing. Resistance may be silent and solitary. It may be clandestine, hidden, or public. It may be, and usually is, nonviolent. In extreme moments, it may be defensively violent. It may be done alone, in a small group, or less often, in a crowd. It may be some simple thing you do once in a while or an action to which you commit your entire life. Resistance is saying no, or turning and going your own way without a word because you no longer consider those in authority to be worth your polite attention. Resistance is taking your own path, regardless of whatever some law, regulation, or convention dictates. It is fighting back with a different set of rules. Resistance is something different to everybody who participates. Anyone who tells you there's only one way to resist is someone you should resist, or better yet, get far, far away from. Monkey wrenching, aka screwing up the works, is resistance. Carrying a weapon for self-defense and defense of others is resistance, especially when a government tells you that you can't. The action that the late, great underground publisher Lumpanics called tax avoidance, avoidance plus evasion, is resistance. Encrypting your communications in the face of an all-seeing Uber government is resistance. Banding together in a militia is resistance, though often a spectacularly ineffective and dangerous form of resistance which we'll touch upon only lightly in this volume. Culture jamming, guerrilla communications designed to cause people to question common perceptions, and dirty tricks can be resistance if done in a certain spirit. Establishing underground communications networks can be a form of resistance. Going off-grid may be a type of resistance, striving for self-sufficiency, or relocating to a freer base of operations. Sometimes whether it's resistance or not depends on your mindset as much as on your actions. We'll talk more about both mindset and methods of resistance as we go. Using, investing in, and paying for goods with cryptocurrency instead of Federal Reserve notes can be resistance, as is purchasing everything in person, with cash, from local businesses and private parties, instead of using a smartphone to grab something from a big online retailer. Quietly helping other resistors even when you must remain publicly pure is resistance. Of course, an armed battle against unjust authority is also resistance. But though it's the type of resistance most of us immediately think of when we consider fighting tyranny, it's actually a last resort, to be pursued only when all else has failed. If other forms of resistance are effective, tyranny yields or collapses without a physical battle. Throughout this book, we'll describe different ways and degrees of resistance. You can take it from there. Because whatever else it is, resistance is an individual choice. Why resist? You resist because you want to remain a free individual, ideally one who lives in a world that's also as free as possible. You resist because the world we now live in is closing off many avenues of freedom. Our privacy is disappearing. Surveillance is everywhere. Our activities are monitored. Any thoughts we have that aren't approved by coastal, Ivy League elitists and their pet media are being censored. Property rights erode. The Second Amendment is being nibbled to death by ignorant zealots. Self-sufficiency is derided as something only dumb rubes could possibly want. The economy is in the hands of kleptocrats. Our very beliefs are under sustained attack. Thus, we resist to stay free. To some, resistance is an obvious and obviously necessary course. Conscience will allow those people to do no less when they are faced with injustice or tyranny. Others might want to resist, but either fear to act or not know what to do. In our present times, with Big Brother's eye everywhere, growing numbers of people are probably in that second category. How to resist can be a perplexing question, but why is simple. Because when political processes fail to protect liberty, and ultimately they always do, resistance is the only path to preserving personal integrity and individual freedom. With a little luck and good timing, it might even preserve or restore political liberty. Support is also resistance. Not everybody is cut out to be an active resistor. Not everybody should be an active resistor. Successful resistance movements require squads of people who outwardly remain paragons of the system while quietly supporting resistance efforts. One of the most important everyday roles for supporters is finance. Resistance operations often need money beyond what those who carry them out can or should have to afford. Sometimes, too, resistors live on the monetary margins and may need support in the same way that religious missionaries or starving artists need it. History is full of successful, mainstream people who provided funds to make big things happen or simply made resistors' lives and work endurable. Other support roles include providing professional services, offering safe houses or even just a hot meal and a shower to someone on the run, providing transportation, disguises, and more. Never disparage or devalue the importance of helpful spirits on the sidelines. 2. Getting started. What we hope ever to do with ease, we must learn first to do with diligence. Samuel Johnson. The most important tool for effective resistance isn't one you have to buy. You don't have to take classes to learn how to use it. No authoritarian thug can take it away from you. Once you have it, there's no danger you'll leave it at home when you need it. The dog can't eat it. And the more you use it, the sharper it gets. That vital resistance tool is a good brain. Now, you could have a good brain for math or art or fixing cars and be lousy at resistance. So let us clarify. A good brain for resistance is one that is proactive, not reactive, is focused on a few important goals at most, not off chasing every distraction, performs actions that have a chance to produce results in support of those goals, is humble, teachable, and learns from experience, extra points if you can learn from the experiences of others, knows itself, is discreet, not prone to fits of temper, and can think rapidly even under stress, is willing and able to grasp basic computer security practices, including encryption and elementary anti-forensics measures, is willing and able to grasp basic physical security practices, including discretion and elementary environmental awareness measures, has a willingness and ability to blend in, understands that it can't save the world, but can still make an important difference. Being proactive means you choose your own agenda. You may be responding to outside circumstances, but you're not letting your buttons be pushed by every random statement or action from an enemy of freedom. Being focused goes hand in hand with being proactive. We live in a time when it's easy and so tempting to tumble into Twitter wars, chase after every conspiracy theory, spend hours following the latest manufactured crisis or scandal. And there's nothing wrong with doing some of those things recreationally. Just don't get hooked on the drug of distraction. You have a goal, or at most a handful of compatible goals. You have a purpose. Remember them. Act on them. Seeking achievable results means you don't try to herd unicorns, unless you're an experienced and well-reputed unicorn herder. You may believe, for instance, that the entire Federal Reserve System and all its funny money has to go. Now. But chances are you can't make that happen. So instead you stockpile silver coins, set up a barter network, invest in cryptocurrencies, or educate willing friends while waiting for the system to weaken on its own, with whatever incremental help you can give it. Learning from experience is a bitch. There's simply no way around that. You start out, you stumble. You flub vital privacy or security protocols. Something you think ought to work goes suddenly and spectacularly wrong. It happens to us all. And what's worse, no matter how experienced we get or how good, we can still screw up occasionally. To err is human, always has been and always will be. But taking every screw-up, every humiliation, every failure as a chance to learn helps us grow that good brain we need. Everybody messes up. Those who don't learn, those who get defensive when corrected, those who fixate on one course of action even when it repeatedly fails them, keep messing up, damaging their own lives and the lives of people who get close to them. The least painful type of learning, though it's not always possible, is to study the methods of others, take inspiration from their successes, and avoid their mistakes. If you see a group in the news that got raided by the feds or had members arrested, for instance, pay attention to what happened and why. That information might keep you or your group from the same fate. Knowing yourself is partly the product of learning from your activist experience. Funny how every aspect of having a good brain is interlinked, isn't it? Partly it just comes from life, and from rubbing elbows with the rest of humanity. Are you a lone wolf? A good organizer? A charismatic speaker? An effective leader? Calm under pressure? A good shot? Someone who can't stand crowds? A person who rubs people the wrong way? A natural-born trickster? Bossy? Submissive? A happy follower? Knowing who you are as a person and what you do and don't do well will save you much heartache, discord, and time in establishing your path of resistance. Forcing ourselves to act in ways that are contrary to our nature or our capabilities increases the chance of failure. For instance, if you're an introvert, you're most likely not the right person to host a party where resistance folks plan to get a politician drunk and put him in a compromising position. That deed may be better perpetrated by a gregarious, extroverted people lover. Play to your strengths and accept that you aren't going to be fantastic at everything. Not doing so endangers your mission and everyone involved in it. Knowing yourself also means not overestimating your skills or letting your ego drive you to take on a dramatic or public role when you're most helpful in the shadows. More on that in a later chapter. Being discreet, not temperamental, and able to think on your feet matter because resistance is a dangerous enough business without people who blab, alienate others, and panic when things go wrong. Having computer security skills doesn't necessarily mean being a genius hacker or coder. It also doesn't mean that you can't become a resistor until you already know all about encryption, virtual private networks, or the pitfalls of social media. It ties in with being teachable and being willing to do what it takes. It means you don't freak out because something is new or complicated. You adapt online as you adapt in life. Blending in is a fantastically useful talent for people who are on confidential, dangerous missions. We'll also talk more about this later. In fact, we'll cover it more than once because it's that important. Not trying to save the world means several things. It means not setting your goals so high you burn out in frustration. Increasingly in our perilous times, it means act locally. You can't save the world. You can help preserve freedom in your neighborhood and perhaps in your city or state. Again, we'll have more specifics later. But while some people dream of becoming martyrs, participating in the Great Revolution, or heroically going out in a blaze of glory, the main work of preserving freedom is actually done quietly, patiently, and sometimes behind the scenes. Be honest with yourself first. While a lot of people think of themselves as perfect for being in the fight, many would actually be better suited to other jobs in the resistance effort. One group we know of was planning to face off against anti-freedom street thugs. They needed a spotter in the coffee shop across the street from a potentially dangerous action. A member of the group was wheelchair-bound, which rendered her unable to do much if things got physical. With arrests and assault probable, she could end up being a liability for the other members, or she could become an asset if she were willing to stay off stage. The group leader asked her to take the lookout post in the coffee shop. "You can't ask me to stay out of the fight," the woman whined. She refused to leave the arena where brutal physical action loomed. Her lack of self-awareness and refusal to be honest with herself about her capabilities and skill set put the entire group in a horrible, potentially dangerous position. Don't be that person. But what about dreaming big, you ask? Surely without big dreams, nothing big happens. Surely the famous founding fathers dreamed big to forge a new nation. Actually, no. At the time of the American Revolution, Boston, one of its major hotbeds, was a small town, 15,000 people. The movers and shakers all knew each other and had a small stage to perform on. Each one of the 13 colonies had its own political personality and small centers of agitation. Even as activists began to communicate from colony to colony via the famous committees of correspondence, there were still diverse factions with widely different priorities and visions. There was no one big dream. For a long time, the only thing the colonists wanted, even the most radical of them, was for the British Crown and Parliament to be economically fair and recognize legitimate local authority. Not until very, very late in the game did anybody dare even think that the colonies would, or should, become a separate nation. It's worth noting that even then they envisioned a loose confederation of independent states, each doing their own thing. Then the Brits decided to confiscate arms, and the shooting started. Nobody even knows who began it. But once a bunch of little people assembled to say no, the big dreamers like Jefferson had to scramble to keep up. Same with the fall of communism. Sure, millions wished with all their hearts that communism would fall. For 70-some years they wished it. Some agitated for it. Some monkey-wrenched the system. Some worked to ensure that the system rushed toward its inevitable bankruptcy. But when the seemingly all-powerful Soviet Union finally crumbled, it wasn't any centralized big dream that pulled it down. Little countries on the periphery triggered the fall by getting independent as centralized authority almost invisibly weakened. The most public moment of its fall came when young, drunk, East Berliners thought they had permission to go party in the West, and a border guard wasn't sure he had the authority to stop them. On the political scale, big dreams are seriously overrated. Worse, they tend to divert energy from the more important small deeds. Even in our own time, the seemingly impossible has often been achieved in small, patient ways. Consider constitutional carry of firearms. For many years, we called it Vermont carry because only one small, quirky state allowed its residents to carry concealed arms, sans permit. And I can tell you that most of us old activist hands, Claire speaking here, thought that's the way it would always be. But state by state, and law by law, small groups of highly focused activists pushed, and pushed, and pushed, and are still pushing. And they changed the nation, and are still changing it, without ever trying to change the entire nation in one fell swoop. They were successful in part because they focused on the attainable, then, having attained it, went to the next level. What the constitutional carry workers did was political activism, rather than pure, beyond political resistance. It's still a damn fine example of what small groups can accomplish by intelligently pursuing clear-cut goals in a focused way. Filtering information. In the course of your resistance, it will become very important to learn to filter information. Much of what we hear, read, or see is bogus. It's an illusion designed to manipulate us. There's government school propaganda that most of us have already been damaged by, designed to mold us into being compliant citizens, soldiers, and workers. There's government/media propaganda designed to keep us in a perpetual state of alarm so we'll yield to whatever our betters want to do to us. There's propaganda put out by corporations, websites, and other parties who simply want to make money from their clickbait. The more shocking and outrageous the stories, the more apt people are to click on it. This type of propaganda also includes twisted statistics, faux surveys, and other uses of false science. And within the resistance movement itself, there are undercover cops, agents provocateurs, false flag operations, stings, and crazed conspiracy theorists all trying to lead us astray, and sometimes lead us to prison. It's not enough just to know they're lying to us. It's vital to understand the hows and whys. In the future, we may write a separate book on recognizing propaganda and separating truth from deception through analysis and critical thinking. For now, here are a few online resources to give you the basics. The Real Purpose of Government Schooling, John Taylor Gatto. The Underground History of American Education. Recognizing Propaganda, the short version.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.